of Joan and Bill Hank and the Hank Center, and on behalf of Susan Romanoff and the Romanoff Seminar, we're so pleased you are here to join us for Revolution of the Heart, a symposium on Dorothy Day. Now, we have a packed schedule, and we'll get to it in short order, but I really wanted to also say thanks for making the trip, and then invite our university president, Dr. Joanne Rooney, to the podium, who has prepared remarks for this gathering of a special welcome. So, thanks, Dr. Rooney. Welcome to my program.
Good evening, everyone. What a great crowd. So thrilled to see everyone here tonight. And welcome to Revolution of the Heart, a two-day symposium on Dorothy Day. I am so pleased to be able to be here with you this evening and welcome you to Loyola University Chicago for what we all know is an extremely important event. Special thanks especially to a number of you who've traveled long distances to be with us. We are so glad everyone is here, and truly from our hearts, welcome to Loyola University. I'm especially pleased to welcome Robert Ellsberg, who is now editor-in-chief of Orbis Books, and who actually knew Dorothy Day during his time as a Catholic worker. In addition, it's wonderful to have Day's granddaughter, Kate Hennessy, with us as well. Is Kate here? Okay. Yeah, I know I'm calling you out. Sorry. Kate will actually speak tomorrow on Dorothy Day's ultimate message of hope, no matter how dark our context may be. Yeah, more than appropriate. You know, and it's interesting, looking around the room, my understanding is that originally the organizers of this event had some modest expectations for attendance. And we're so pleased that it generated much more interest than perhaps we initially expected. It's always wonderful when you want to know if you do have enough room and seats for people. So we're ecstatic. And I suspect, though, that it's really the interest in Dorothy Day's life comes from watching a strong, intelligent, courageous woman, fully engaged with the Gospels and the message of Jesus that the kingdom of God is at hand. Her life was complicated and sometimes messy, which I think makes it easy for most of us to identify with her, given so much of our own ups and downs that we experience all the time. You will recall that Pope Francis mentioned Dorothy in his 2015 address to the United States Congress, a message I hope continues to be heard, underscoring not only the central role she played in American religious history, but to celebrate her as a true American identity, an approach to citizenship that is tireless in its quest for social justice. Her example of a lived commitment to justice endures, but it challenges all of us, those who profess to be Catholics, but indeed all people who advocate for a more just and humane world. Dorothy reminds us of who we claim to be, but her example demands that we seriously examine how we care for one another, but especially the poor and marginalized in our society. I do hope that this symposium ignites further interest in this extraordinary woman's life and writings. I especially want to thank the faculty who organized and planned this two-day meeting, and with special thanks to the Hank Center and the Romanoff Seminar, and the several other co-sponsors that we are pleased to say are listed in the symposium program. This collaboration demonstrates Dorothy Day's wide appeal across our academic departments here at Loyola and among our student body. I would now like to invite Michelle Nickerson, Associate Professor of History and instructor of the seminar, Dorothy Day's America, Catholicism in the 20th Century United States. please come to the podium to introduce this evening's speaker. And again, welcome, and thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. Good evening, friends, colleagues, Catholic workers, former Catholic workers, and students. On behalf of the Ramanaut Seminar, I'm happy to welcome you to Loyola's campus for the final lecture in our speaker series by Robert Ellsberg. The Ramanaut Seminar in American Catholic History and Culture is an interdisciplinary two-semester course that provides Loyola undergraduates with the unique opportunity to explore changing topics within American Catholic history through hands-on research. Taught alternately by a Loyola faculty member or a recent PhD in Catholic history, the seminar is limited to 12 students who pursue common readings in the fall semester and individual research projects in the spring semester. The seminar provides students with resources for research, travel, and even publication in digital and print formats, all aimed at their general professional development. The best final research paper or digital project from each year's seminar, voted on by a panel of three faculty judges, wins the Susan Ramanaut Prize for Scholarly Excellence. With the theme of this year's seminar, Dorothy Day's America, students are learning about the history of social, environmental, and economic justice in the United States by walking through the 20th century in the shoes of Dorothy Day. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our guest, Robert Ellsberg, who has worked for the past 30 years as editor-in-chief and publisher of Orbis Books, the publishing arm of the Mary Knoll Fathers and Brothers. In 1975, Ellsberg dropped out of Harvard to work with Dorothy Day at the Catholic Worker in New York City. He remained part of that community for the last 5 years of Day's life and served for 2 years as managing editor of the Catholic Worker, that is the newspaper. After her death in 1980, he edited her selected writings. He completed his undergraduate degree in religion and literature and later earned a master's in theology from Harvard Divinity School. He has continued to promote the messages and legacy of Dorothy Day through his writings and served as the editor of The Duty of Delight, the diaries of Dorothy Day, as well as All the Ways to Heaven, selected letters of Dorothy Day. He has written many other award-winning books, including All Saints, Daily Reflections on Saints, Prophets, and Witnesses for Our Time, Blessed Among All Women, and The Saint's Guide to Happiness. In addition, he has edited anthologies by Gandhi, Flannery O'Connor, Thich Nhat Hanh, Harvey Cox, and many others. For the past 6 years, he has contributed a daily reflection on saints for Give Us This Day, a monthly prayer journal published by Liturgical Press. Last year, a collection of those pieces for every day was published as Blessings Among Us. Please join me in welcoming Robert Ellsberg.
Or you speak to work. This one work?
Yeah.
That work? You hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here and glad that the program will continue tomorrow, which I really look forward to. Do a little Kellyanne Conway bit here and say, I hope you all go out and buy Kate Hennessy's amazing book. You don't have to go online, it's right here. You don't have to go to Nordstrom's. I'm looking forward to hearing her speak tomorrow. Maybe we'll talk more about my admiration for that book later. Yeah, do I have to go lean down like this a little bit? So a little cabaret style. Is that okay? Right. Well, let's travel back yesteryear. On June 15th, 1955, at the sound of a wailing siren that signaled an imminent nuclear attack, the entire population of New York City obediently sought shelter in basements in subway stations, or in the case of school children, under their desks. According to the authorities, this first in a series of annual civil defense drills was a complete success. Well, almost. It was marred by a middle-aged, white-haired woman and 26 others who refused to play along with this war game. Rather than take shelter, Dorothy Day and her companions instead sat in City Hall Park, where they were arrested and later sentenced to jail. The judge who imposed bail likened the protesters to murderers who had contributed to, quote, the utter destruction of these 3 million theoretically killed in our city. Of course, 3 million, the number of theoretical fatalities of a nuclear strike in New York City, would hardly have measured the potential devastation. Actual plans for nuclear war involved deaths in the hundreds of millions. As Dorothy Day saw it, the illusion that nuclear war was survivable and therefore winnable made such a monstrous war more likely. To participate in such an exercise for doomsday, she believed, was an act of blasphemy, and so she went to jail. On that clear spring day in 1955, it was more than 20 years since Dorothy Day had founded the Catholic Worker. At first a newspaper, and then a movement consisting of houses of hospitality in New York City and slum neighborhoods across the country. In such communities, the works of mercy, feeding the hungry, sheltering the homeless, clothing the naked, were combined with a commitment to social justice and the vision of an alternative society based on the values of generosity, compassion, and solidarity, rather than selfishness, greed, and fear. There were many who admired her work among the poor. Among the original subscribers to her newspaper, founded in the heart of the Depression, there were plenty who sympathized with her critique of an economic system that produced such poverty and desperation. Few in those early years joined Day in her conviction that the way of Jesus was also incompatible with any kind of killing, a most controversial stand which she maintained throughout World War II. And on the day of that first civil defense drill in New York City, the number of Catholics who agreed that this was a crime against God and humanity could evidently fit inside a single police wagon. But for Dorothy, it all went together. The Catholic Church, Catholic Worker, was an effort to live out the radical implications of the teaching of Christ, that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, whether feed them, jail them, or bomb them, we do directly to Him. For almost 50 years, until her death in 1980, Dorothy lived by these convictions. As a result, she received a fair amount of criticism. Some called her un-American. She was charged with being weak, irrelevant, and foolish. In reply, she stated, "We confess to being foolish and wish that we were more so." Some accused her of being a secret communist. In the 1950s, J. Edgar Hoover, director of the FBI, placed her name on a list of dangerous radicals to be detained in the event of a national emergency. And yet, the tide has evidently turned. In 2000, Cardinal John O'Connor submitted her cause for canonization in Rome, where, upon its acceptance, she was named a servant of God. In 2012, the U.S. Catholic bishops joined Cardinal Timothy Dolan in endorsing that cause, a long process that may conclude one day in her becoming Saint Dorothy. If so, she will certainly be a saint with an unusual backstory, including her arrest on behalf of women's suffrage, her work with socialist papers and other left-leaning organizations. And then there was her decision following an unhappy love affair to have an abortion. All this occurred before her conversion to Catholicism, yet even the circumstances of that conversion are unique in the annals of the saints. This occurred while she was living in Staten Island with a man she deeply loved, though they were not married, and the discovery that she was once again pregnant. This time, in her gratitude, she found herself praying and wishing to have her child baptized, a step she eventually followed. The Catholic Worker came 5 years later when she was 35, following a long, lonely search for her vocation. Aside from the painful separation from her child's father, he was an anarchist who didn't believe in marriage, she had experienced another loss, the feeling that in joining the church, so often a bastion of the status quo, she had betrayed the cause of the oppressed. In December 1932, while covering a labor march in Washington, D.C., She prayed at the shrine of the Immaculate Conception that God would open up some way for her to use her talents on behalf of the poor. And when she returned to New York City, she met Peter Morin, an itinerant Frenchman whose personalist philosophy seemed an answer to her prayer. He inspired her to start a newspaper to promote the social vision of the gospel, and in the houses of hospitality that ensued, Day and the Catholic workers practiced what they preached, living among the poor, performing the works of mercy, trying to live out the radical implications of the love of God and neighbor. Of course, by feeding a few hundred hungry people every morning, Day did not believe that she could solve the problems of the Depression. Nor years later, when she sat out the civil defense drills and went to jail, did she believe that such gestures would bring an end to war. But like Jesus, who spoke of the mysterious potential of a mustard seed, Dorothy believed in the power hidden in small means. In this, she drew surprising lessons from her favorite saint, Thérèse of Lisieux. At first glance, there would appear to be little in common between these two women, Day the activist and Thérèse, a Carmelite nun who died at the age of 24 in a small convent in Normandy. They were actually linked by a curious coincidence, the fact that Dorothy was born in 1897, the very year of Thérèse's death. Thérèse's spirituality of the little way consisted of performing all the small deeds and obligations of our daily life in a spirit of love and in the presence of God. In this way, she believed, our everyday life, with its constant opportunities to exercise patience, forgiveness, and compassion, could become an arena for holiness. You didn't have to be in a convent. You didn't have to face lions in the Colosseum. Everyday life provided the means for sanctification. Furthermore, Thérèse believed strongly in the spiritual connections that bind all members of the mystical body of Christ. Thus, each sacrifice endured in love, each work of mercy, did not just advance one's own path to holiness. It might increase the balance of love in the world. There was no telling what effect our prayers and small sacrifices could have around the globe on people we might never meet. Dorothy's devotion to Thérèse was particularly ironic in light of her original impression. Upon first reading Thérèse's autobiography, which Dorothy received from a priest soon after her conversion, she found it, quote, colorless, monotonous, too small, in fact, for my notice. In short, pious pap. What kind of a saint was this, she said, who felt that she had to practice heroic charity in eating what was put in front of her, and taking medicine, enduring cold and heat, enduring the society of mediocre souls, and following the strict regime of the convent of Carmelite nuns, which she had joined at the age of 15. And yet Dorothy would come to see in Thérèse not only a great saint, but one with a message particularly relevant for our times. What accounted for this change of heart? The answer lies in her experience with the Catholic worker. Through years of living among the poor and unwanted, enduring not only cold and heat, but also the sights and smells of squalor, she came to appreciate in a different way the power of Thérèse's little way. Dorothy's diaries, which I edited some years ago, record the discipline of her spiritual life, daily mass, the rosary, rising early to read from scripture. But they also record the constant discipline required to curb her anger and impatience, and to practice charity in her dealings with those closest at hand. Don't suppose for a minute that Dorothy had a placid disposition. When someone once told her to hold her temper, she replied, "I hold more temper in 1 minute than you will in your entire lifetime." The title I gave to her diaries, The Duty of Delight, is taken from a phrase she liked to repeat. It appears in the postscript to her autobiography, The Long Loneliness, where she writes, "It's not easy always to be joyful, to keep in mind the duty of delight." It says a lot about Day's spirituality. It's one thing to love people who are lovable. It's one thing to feel delight when things are delightful. But the heart of the gospel is adding love, even when there is no love. Loving the person beside us, even if that person is disagreeable. Living for so many years in a fractious community, made up of so many broken and damaged souls, was a truly heroic task. But if you willed to love someone, if you willed to see Christ in them, you could do it. That's what Dorothy believed. It didn't mean it was any easier for Dorothy than for the rest of us. Yet it was the exercise of her faith in these small ways, the effort to live her daily life in the conscious presence of God, that equipped her for the extraordinary and heroic actions she performed on a wider stage. At the same time, with St. Thérèse, Day believed strongly in the power of things that are apparently marginal and of little account. She actually spent many years writing a book about Thérèse, motivated, she said, by her desire to call attention to the social implications of Thérèse's teachings, the significance of all the little things we do or fail to do. This included the protests we make, appearing foolish while standing on a street corner with a sign for peace, or handing out a leaflet, or going to jail for a few days. These gestures, though apparently foolish and ineffective, no more than a pebble in a pond, might set forth ripples that could transform the world. In the Gospels, this principle is illustrated in the story of Jesus' multiplication of the loaves and fishes. Dorothy drew on that image, loaves and fishes, for the title of one of her books. There she wrote, "One of the greatest evils of the day is the sense of futility. Young people say, what good can one person do? What is the sense of our small effort? They cannot see that we must lay one brick at a time, take one step at a time. We can be responsible only for the action of the present moment, but we can beg for an increase of love in our hearts that will vitalize and transform all our individual actions, and know that God will take them and multiply them as Jesus multiplied the loaves and fishes." I believe that Dorothy's application of St. Thérèse's little way to the social arena is really one of the most significant and at the same time underappreciated aspects of her witness. In a world in which everything is measured by numbers, metrics, return on investment, it's so hard for us to appreciate that there's any other way of measuring value and success. But then how are we to understand Christ's message that it is only if the seed falls into the ground and dies that it bears much fruit? Dorothy summed this all up in one of her most frequently cited lines. "The greatest challenge of the day is this: how to bring about a revolution of the heart, a revolution which has to start with each one of us." Just as St. Thérèse and Dorothy Day would appear on the surface to be cut from very different cloth, the same might be said of Dorothy and the current Bishop of Rome. On the one hand, a single mother, a layperson who came to the Catholic Church in her 30s after a life immersed in social activism. On the other hand, the son of Italian immigrants in Argentina, who was raised as a Catholic and early in his life felt a call to the priesthood. This is not to say that Jorge Bergoglio lived a sheltered clerical life. He comes from a missionary order, the Society of Jesus, you know well here, that in the 1970s made a decisive shift to define its mission as the promotion of faith that does justice. He comes from a Latin American church that contributed the notion of a preferential option for the poor. He served as provincial of the Society of Jesus during the dirty war in Argentina, when tens of thousands of people, including many priests, sisters, and lay Catholics, some of whom he knew well, were tortured and disappeared by the military government and its death squads. While serving as Archbishop of Buenos Aires, he urged his priests to work in the slums and shantytowns. All of this he brought with him at the time of his election as Pope in the conclave in 2013. I would not assume that he had heard of Dorothy Day before that time. And yet over and over again in his words and actions, it has almost seemed as if he were channeling her spirit. I thought of this especially in connection with his call for a revolution of tenderness, a catchphrase that he's repeated in many of his writings and statements. Despite their differences in background and age, Dorothy was old enough to be his mother, they obviously read the same Gospels. But more significantly, they read the Gospels through what you could call a Franciscan lens. This is a perspective that highlights Jesus' poverty, what you might call his option for those on the margins. Through this lens, one notices that Jesus seemed especially drawn to the poor, the unclean, and sinners, less so to the important and powerful ones, including the good religious people of his day, who were more inclined to want to kill him. Jesus opted for the way of self-emptying, relinquishment of worldly power and influence. And as Dorothy always liked to point out, he achieved his mission by way of apparent failure. This same was true for St. Francis, who pursued the renewal of the church by recalling the image of Jesus in his own poverty and in friendship with the poor and marginalized. Dorothy Day constantly invoked the example and teachings of St. Francis, extolling his love of poverty and his joyful spirit, and expressing her own desire to emulate his sense of freedom and abandon, sometimes with mixed results. "I have kissed a leper not once but twice consciously," she said, "and I can't say I am much the better for it." As for the Pope, it has been obvious from the beginning that his choice to be called Francis was more than a name. It implied an agenda and a program for renewal. One of the most significant facts about St. Francis was his utter rejection of the logic of success, power, and importance. From the beginning, Pope Francis has signaled a similar reversal of values by rejecting the symbols of status and privilege, including right away his decision to live in a guest house of Santa Marta rather than in the traditional papal residence. But this has been more than an expression of humility. It has reflected Pope Francis's continuous critique of what he calls spiritual worldliness, the tendency by those in the church to cling to worldly standards of success, influence, and status. He has called this spiritual worldliness one of the most pernicious dangers facing the church today. In the priorities he proposed before the 2013 conclave, then Cardinal Jorge Bergoglio spoke of the need for the church to step outside of itself, to let go of its self-referentiality and introversion, to go to the margins and the peripheries, to touch the wounds of Christ. He has shown what that means in a church that confronts the social structures of sin, that works for peace and ecological wholeness, and embodies a spirit of mercy and reconciliation. Simply put, that is the vision that Dorothy Day embodied. Thus, it did not come as a total surprise when Pope Francis, while visiting the United States last year, invoked her name. More surprising was the context. In an address before a joint session of Congress and among a group of four great Americans, as he called them, including Abraham Lincoln, Martin Luther King Jr., and Thomas Merton, around whom he organized his remarks. "In these times, when social concerns are so important," he stated, "I cannot fail to mention the servant of God, Dorothy Day, who founded the Catholic worker movement. Her social activism, her passion for justice and for the cause of the oppressed, were inspired by the gospel, her faith, and the example of the saints." I can only imagine a certain amount of head scratching in Congress and beyond that greeted these words. The two Catholics he named, Day and Merton, were hardly household names, and those in Congress who did recognize her name might have been aware that Dorothy had been called many other things besides a great American, such as traitor, heretic, subversive, and of course communist. Now we'd see nasty woman. Lest you think that this was in the distant past when Dorothy Day's cause for canonization was endorsed by the U.S. bishops, a state senator from Virginia wrote Pope Benedict to say he was revolted by the thought that a person of such loathsome character might be considered a saint. That would not have deterred Pope Francis. When his Joy of the Gospel was published, there were critics who also accused him of sounding like a Marxist. Rush Limbaugh and others. This is the inevitable reaction whenever Christians go beyond feeding the hungry to ask why there are so many hungry people. Beyond simply caring for the poor, Dorothy believed it was also necessary to challenge, protest, and resist those social structures that cause such poverty and the need for so much charity. The seeds of this conviction extended back to her early life. In her autobiography, she recalls how her heart had been stirred by stories of the saints and their charity toward the sick, the maimed, the leper. "But there was another question in my mind," she said. "Why was so much done in remedying the evil instead of avoiding it in the first place? Where were the saints to try to change the social order, not just to minister to the slaves, but to do away with slavery?" In effect, her vocation took form around this challenge. Because of Dorothy Day, future generations of Christians would not have to ask her question, "Where are the saints to try to change the social order?" It's a question she answered with her own life. How could Pope Francis fail to recognize in Dorothy Day a kindred spirit? In his apostolic exhortation, The Joy of the Gospel, he wrote in terms that might have appeared in the Catholic Worker. Just as the commandment, thou shalt not kill, sets a clear limit in order to safeguard the value of human life, today we must also say, thou shalt not, to an economy of exclusion and inequality. Such an economy kills. In words that Dorothy might have written, he observed, how can it be that it is not a news item when an elderly homeless person dies of exposure, but it is news when the stock market loses 2 points? In his first trip out of Italy, the Pope visited the island of Lampedusa, a way station for immigrants where thousands are drowned at sea. There he decried a culture of comfort and the globalization of indifference that renders us incapable of feeling the pain of others. Who weeps for these victims, he asked. Clearly Pope Francis does, and so did Dorothy Day before him. Before the Pope's trip to America, I had imagined the pleasure of telling him about this American Catholic who had so embraced his vision of a church that is poor and for the church and for the poor, whose call for a revolution of the heart was echoed by his own call for a revolution of tenderness. I would have described how she touched the wounds of Christ every day, how she spoke out and demonstrated against war and injustice, going to jail in solidarity with striking farm workers or protesting plans for nuclear war, how she stood virtually alone among Catholics of her day in bearing witness to the gospel message of nonviolence, the commandment to love our enemies. I would have told the Pope how Dorothy exemplified the Beatitudes, that hers is the face that comes to my mind when I envision the poor of spirit, the meek, the pure of heart, the mournful, the peacemakers, and those who hunger and thirst for God's righteousness. But evidently no intervention on my part was necessary. Pope Francis was apparently well briefed about Dorothy Day before undertaking his trip. His references to Day, Merton, Lincoln, and King were only part of a remarkable speech in which he expressed his solidarity with immigrants and refugees, the object of so much fear and vilification today, called for abolition of the death penalty, affirmed that the common good also includes the earth, denounced the blood-drenched arms trade, and defined what it means to make America great, to invoke a familiar catchphrase, in terms of the dreams embodied by his four great Americans. But what, on the other hand, if I could have sat down with Dorothy Day to tell her about Pope Francis? How thrilling it would be to tell her about a pope who took his name from St. Francis. So often she criticized the ecclesial trappings of power and privilege. How she would have delighted in Francis's gestures of humility, his call for shepherds who have the smell of the sheep, his washing the feet of prisoners. With her love for the Cuban people, how glad she would have been to know of his role in resolving the diplomatic impasse between our countries. With her lifetime among the poor and discarded, how she would have resonated with his words, I prefer a church which is bruised, hurting, and dirty because it has been out on the streets, rather than a church which is unhealthy from being confined and from clinging to its own security. How moved she would be to learn of his deep friendship with a Jewish rabbi, his love for opera and Dostoevsky, and his exhortation to spread the joy of the gospel. She always respected church leaders, but in such a pope, I believe, she would have recognized the fulfillment of her dreams. But there is another personal level in which Dorothy would connect with a pope who could describe himself simply as a sinner whom the Lord has looked upon. Her early life was marked by her passion for social justice, but also by much sadness and moral confusion. Following her abortion, she twice tried to commit suicide. As she wrote in her diary, aside from drug addiction, I committed all the sins young people commit today. It was later, after again finding herself pregnant, that she felt such a joy and gratitude for the mercy of God that she decided to become a Catholic. Looking back on all this, she could observe, God has been so good to me. For Dorothy, gratitude was the final word, for the life and faith she had been given and for the vocation she had found. How she would have appreciated Pope Francis's words, I have a dogmatic certainty. God is in every person's life. Even if the life of a person has been a disaster, God is in this person's life. Although the life of a person is a land full of thorns and weeds, there's always a space in which the good seed can grow. You have to trust God. That was Dorothy's experience. It was God's mercy that drew her to the church. how could she not love a pope who has made mercy the signature theme of his papacy? In invoking Dorothy Day and his other models, Pope Francis said, such men and women offer us a way of seeing and interpreting reality. In the context of Dorothy Day's proposed canonization, a cause that is currently in process, perhaps Pope Francis's words help us understand what this means. We are accustomed to thinking of saints as people who stand out for their heroic faith and witness to gospel values. But before their bold and courageous actions, perhaps what distinguishes such people is their way of seeing and interpreting reality. They look at the world through a gospel lens, and in doing so, they see things according to a different scale of value. What would it look like if we measured the greatness of America by how we treat the poorest, the prisoners, the refugees, and immigrants? What would it mean if we saw in the poor and homeless, as Dorothy Day did, the face of Christ? We might not immediately open our homes as she did at the Catholic Worker, but perhaps we would not be so susceptible to what Pope Francis calls the culture of indifference. I think that among the many things Pope Francis and Dorothy share in common is their recognition of the value of small gestures and poor means. One of the Pope's favorite mottos is this: time is greater than space. As he explains, this principle enables us to work slowly but surely without being obsessed with immediate results. Giving priority to time means being concerned about initiating processes rather than possessing spaces. Time governs spaces, illuminates them, and makes them links in a constantly expanding chain with no possibility of return. Compare that to Dorothy's words. What we do is very little, but it is like the little boy with a few loaves and fishes. Christ took that little and increased it. He will do the rest. What we do is so little, we may seem to be constantly failing, but so did he fail. He met with apparent failure on the cross. But unless the seed fall into the earth and die, there is no harvest. And why must we see results? Our work is to sow. Another generation will be reaping the harvest. This, of course, has much bearing on the Pope's strategy for change, both in the church and in the world. Many people focus on seizing power, occupying space, but for the Pope, the key thing is planting seeds, initiating processes. The revolution of the heart, the revolution of tenderness, does not depend on seizing power or occupying space, but initiates a process of change that may in the end prove more durable. Dorothy lived out her own vocation in the Catholic Worker movement, but she set an example for all Christians, reminding us that the gospel is meant to be lived and challenging us to find our own unique path of faithful discipleship. We didn't need to enter a monastery or found a religious order or join the Catholic Worker to begin right now to contribute to the balance of love in the world, to contribute to the balance of peace. And what about those civil defense drills in the 1950s? Whatever happened to those? Dorothy was arrested in successive annual drills and twice served 30-day sentences. While lying in jail, during one of these experiences, a setting that might have given rise to thoughts of the futility of such small gestures in light of the massive resources of the war machine, she instead found herself, quote, thinking of war and peace and the problem of human freedom and the apathy of great masses of people who believe that nothing can be done. When I thought of these things, I was all the more confirmed in my faith in the little way of Saint Therese. We do the minute things that come to hand. We pray our prayers and beg also for an increase of faith, and God will do the rest. And perhaps her prayers were answered. In 1961, she was joined by 2,000 other protesters who refused to cooperate, and that was the last there was of any of those civil defense drills. If I may, I'd like to conclude with some personal recollections. I like to quote her granddaughter, Kate Hennessy, who said that to have known Dorothy Day means spending the rest of your life wondering what hit you. I hope I didn't steal a lead for your lecture. That is certainly the case for me. I first met Dorothy in the summer of 1975 when I was 19. I, as was mentioned, dropped out of college after my sophomore year and made my way down to St. Joseph House in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, drawn by a number of motivations. I was eager to experience something of life firsthand, apart from books. I was tired of living for myself alone and longed to give myself to something larger and more meaningful. I had a pretty good idea of what I was against, but I wanted to find out something about what I was for. Dorothy was familiar with such motivations. "What's it all about, the Catholic worker movement?" she asked in one of her last columns. "It is, in a way, a school, a work camp to which large-hearted, socially conscious young people come to find their vocations. After some months or years, they know most definitely what they want to do with their lives. They learn not only to love with compassion, but to overcome fear. In my case, I had intended to stay just a few months, but I ended up remaining for 5 years, how things go, which did turn out to be the last 5 years of Dorothy's life. And in the end, I did find much of what I'd been seeking, and probably more. I remember our first encounter. Dwight McDonald, in a famous New Yorker profile, once compared Dorothy to, quote, "an elderly schoolteacher or librarian. She has the typical air of mild authority and of being no longer surprised at anything children or book borrowers might do." Naturally, I was a little apprehensive. Knowing the importance of first impressions, I had spent a lot of time preparing to ask just the right question. But when the moment came, all I could do was blurt out, "How do you reconcile Catholicism and anarchism?" And she looked at me with that bemused expression I came to know well and said, "It's never been a problem for me." Lacking a follow-up question, I had no choice but to withdraw and ponder her answer, wondering whether it contained some deep Zen meaning. Over time, I came to realize that Dorothy wasn't particularly interested in abstractions. The interesting question for Dorothy was how ideals were lived out and set in motion, whether in the case of St. Francis or St. Teresa or Sacco and Vanzetti, Tolstoy, Chekhov. And by the same token, she was fascinated by other people and their stories, where they came from, where they'd traveled, what books they liked. "What's your favorite novel of Dostoevsky?" was a question she might ask. And it wasn't a test. It was genuinely curious about your answer. And it turned out not to be that hard to get to know her, especially if you weren't overly reverent. She thrived on conversations over a cup of coffee or around the kitchen table. She had a sly sense of humor and an almost girlish laugh, which people are surprised to hear about, given those severe photographs that she's known for. A few months after my arrival, Dorothy asked me to become the managing editor of the Catholic Worker paper. She was largely in retirement, and the management of the house and the newspaper, day-to-day work of hospitality, were in the hands of those she called the young people. At 20, I definitely qualified as young. Otherwise, I had no other qualifications. I wasn't even a Catholic. My appointment evidently had more to do with the fact that nobody else was particularly interested in the job. Nevertheless, Dorothy had an uncanny ability to discern and encourage people's hidden gifts and talents. She had faith in people, and she was able to make them feel her faith as well. Needless to say, I could hardly imagine at the time that she was pointing me in the direction of my life's work and vocation. Dorothy didn't always endorse my editorial decisions, especially if the articles were too long or my tone was too sarcastic or the illustrations were too lugubrious. The only instruction I can recall was the time she told me, "Your job as editor is to make sure I don't sound like a fool." That turned out to be the least challenging part of the job. Life at the Catholic Worker involved constant improvisation. One day it might involve getting up early to help prepare for the morning line, the 100 or so down and out men and women who showed up each day, rain or shine, for a bowl of soup, some bread and tea. It might involve adjudicating a dispute between unruly guests in the House of Hospitality, which I like to call the ambassadors of God, or welcoming visitors, folding newspapers to be mailed across the country, begging for vegetables at the wholesale market, or cleaning one of the regularly clogged toilets. My personal talents did not lie in that area. But it might also involve handing out anti-war leaflets before indifferent crowds on Fifth Avenue, or marching in demonstrations, or sitting in at the Pentagon. You just never knew. As for Dorothy, she answered the mail, said her prayers, attended daily mass at the local parish when she was able, and joined the community at the end of the day in reciting evening prayers. Dorothy was attracted to young people. their idealism, their energy, their instinct, as she liked to say, for the heroic. We must always aim for the impossible, she said. If we lower our goal, we also diminish our effort. And she was understanding of our mistakes and foibles. The memory of her own youthful struggles made her particularly sensitive to the searchings and sufferings of youth. To a young woman in distress, she wrote, "Please forgive me for presuming to write you so personally, to intrude on you and your suffering as I'm doing, but I felt I had to, because I've gone through so much the same suffering as you in the confusion of my youth and my search for love. It's a very real agony of our own, wanting human love, fulfillment, and one so easily sees all the imperfections of this love we seek, the inability of others ever to satisfy this need of ours, the constant failure of those nearest and dearest to understand, to respond." Dorothy spent most of her life among the down and out, amidst the sights and smells of poverty, eating plain and often ill-prepared food, enduring bed bugs and lice constantly, worrying about sufficient funds to cover the cost of the lights or the beans for the soup. In other words, putting up with sacrifices and worries as rigorous as anything St. Therese could have envisioned. In light of this reality, I was surprised to discover her fastidious nature and her cultivated tastes, her love of classical music, the opera, flowers, beautiful things. She loved to quote Dostoevsky's words, "The world will be saved by beauty." There's a famous story about the time someone donated a diamond ring to the Catholic worker. Everyone wondered what Dorothy would do with it. Could have paid for a lot of beans. She gave it to an old woman who used to hang around the worker, a woman so disagreeable that she had earned the nickname the Weasel. When it was pointed out that the ring could cover her rent for most of a year, Dorothy said she could do with it what she wanted. Use it for rent, take a trip to the Bahamas, or keep it to admire. As she said, "Do you suppose God created diamonds only for the rich?" When I heard that story, I recognized that distinctive audacity or over-the-topness that distinguishes holiness from just being especially nice. Whether it is St. Francis kissing a leper or the woman who wasted a large quantity of oil anointing Christ's body. In the realm of her social activism, it has its analog in her reply to an exasperated IRS agent who asked her to estimate how much federal income tax she thought she owed. "Why don't you just figure it out, how much I owe, then tell me, and then I just won't pay it." I knew Dorothy in her last years as she was steadily letting go. She who had spent so much of her life on a constant bus trip from one end of the country to the other, was confined first to the city, then to Mary House, and finally to her room on the second floor, where she surveyed the activities on Third Street, which the worker shared with the Hell's Angels. In her youth, she wrote, she had received a great revelation that for anyone attuned to the life of the mind, the future held the promise of unending fascination. "No matter how old I get, my heart can still leap for joy as I read and suddenly assent to some great truth enunciated by some great mind and heart." I received word of her death on November 29th, 1980, some months after I had returned to college. I remembered our last meeting in her room at Mary House, surrounded by her favorite books, icons, and picture postcards. After 5 years at the Catholic Worker, I had become a Catholic. "Well, now you'll have a better idea of what you're interested in," she said. She embraced me with a maternal kiss. "Don't forget about us," she said, as if that were any danger. And then she remembered that I told her I would be studying literature. "What about Dostoevsky?" she asked. "What's your favorite of his novels?" It's surprising how few are the truly significant moments in our lives, how often we don't recognize them at the time. Dorothy ended her autobiography with this thought: "We were just sitting there talking when Peter Morin came in. We were just sitting there talking when lines of people began to form saying, 'We need bread.' It was as casual as all that, I often think. It just came about. It just happened." And it often seems that way for me too, when I look back on my life. It just happened. And the talk and the witness and the daily acts of faith and love continued long after I'd moved on. "You'll know your vocation," Dorothy once said, "by the joy it gives you." It was not my vocation to remain serving soup at the Catholic Worker, but evidently it was my vocation to become an editor. In fact, incredibly enough, Dorothy Day's editor, and it has given me joy. I was very young when we met. More than 40 years later, I'm still wondering what hit me. In the end, I guess I would say that Dorothy Day gave me a life and a sense of direction. And with this, a mission to tell her story and bear witness to her message as best as I can. As for learning not only to love with compassion, but to overcome fear, I'm still learning. No matter how old you get, some lessons are never really finished. Thanks very much.